So, dear students, let us continue our discussion on the problems. In this session, we are going to finish off all the problems, most of the problems from the chapter electric charges and fields. And now, the next question from the continuation. Okay, question number 30. 5 point charges in the ratio 1:2:3:4:5 are enclosed by a spherical surface of radius 0.2 meter. If the net flux through the surface is 377 Newton meters square per coulomb, calculate the least value of the charge enclosed. So according to the given data, we have 5 charges enclosed by a spherical surface, right? A spherical surface is enclosing 5 charges. We don't know what are the charges present inside the given spherical surface, but we do know what is the ratio of the given charges. The ratio of the given charges is 1:2:3:4:5. So I can take, we don't know the charges, I can take the charges as Q1 is equal to some charge X, okay? For simplicity, be keeping it as X. And Q2 is equal to, how much Q2 will be? Say this is Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5. All these charges are enclosed in this spherical surface. Now, I have considered Q1 as X coulomb, okay? Q1 is X coulomb. Coulomb C is the unit, X is the variable chosen. So what are the values of Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5 will be? Q2 will be 2X coulomb, right? Because they are in the ratio 1:2:3:4:5. And similarly, Q3 will be 3X, Q4 will be 4X coulomb, Q5 will be 5x coulomb. These are the charges which we can consider, okay? Since we don't know the actual values of charges, we can take them in the ratio in this way. And now, what they have given is the total flux through this surface. So it is somewhat like a Gaussian surface. In this Gaussian surface, we are getting electric flux due to all these charges together. So the total flux through the surface phi is equal to 377 Newton meter squared per coulomb. These are the given data. And what is asked to find? Calculate the least value of the charge. So among all these 5 charges, which is the least valued charge? Q1 is the least valued charge, right? Which is X. So what we need to find is this X itself. The value of X has to be found. So which law helps us to find the charge? It's very simple. Gauss law helps us to find the value of least charge. Gauss law states that, we have discussed it so many times, the total electric flux through an enclosed surface, okay, irrespective of shape of surface or any size of the surface, the total electric flux through the surface is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the total charge enclosed by the surface. Okay, should be careful with that total term, because so far whatever the problems we have discussed till now, we have considered a single charge kept inside a surface, right? Here we have 5 charges inside the surface. So here all these charges contribute for the electric flux, right? So we have to consider the total charge and then substitute for the Gauss law, right? So according to Gauss law, phi is equal to Q, let me take capital Q, which represent total charge, Q by epsilon naught, right? What is Q? Q is the total charge enclosed by this surface. What is that Q equal to? Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 plus Q4 plus Q5. Now, substitute all these values. Q1 as x, Q2 as 2x. Okay, so it is going to be x plus 2x plus 3x plus 4x plus 5x, which is going to be x plus 2x. 1, 3, 6, 10, 15. 15x is the total charge enclosed. Now we have the value of total charge. Let me substitute that value of Q into this. The given value of phi is 377. So 377 is equal to Q is 15x divided by epsilon naught. The value of epsilon naught, 8.85 into 10 to the power of minus 12. Right? Now you simplify this. Okay? Use your calculator and simplify, you'll get the value of x. So the value of x, whatever you will get now, is the least charge inside the given surface. Clear with this? You have to simplify for the value of x. Okay, it's just the multiplication and division left. You need to do that, and that's it. Such a simple solution. Okay? Right. Let us move ahead for the next question. Next question is as follows. ABCD is a square of side root 2 meter. The point charges 1 nanocoulomb, 2 nanocoulomb, 3 nanocoulomb are placed at the corners A, B and C respectively. Calculate the electric field at corner D. So what we have here is a square shaped arrangement. Let me rub this. I hope you've taken the question. Okay, so what we have here is a square ABCD, right? ABCD. It's a square of side around 2 meters. And we have three charges kept at A, B and C. I think it's 1, 2 and 3 nanocoulombs. Let me check once. Yes. So at A we have 1 nanocoulomb charge, and at B we have 2 nanocoulomb charge, and at C we have 3 nanocoulomb charge placed. Now all these three charges will have their own electric fields towards the point D. They will have the electric field in all directions, and hence obviously to the direction of towards D also. So let me keep it here. Let the electric field at D due to the charge at A be EA and will be directed like this. Positive charge away from the positive charge. Clear? Now let the electric field due to the charge C at D be this. Let me call this as EC. And how about EB? EB acts along the diagonal of the square. Okay? Upon the extension of BD, we will get the direction of EB. So, this is how EB will be. Now, since the shape is a square, we can expect that the angle between the lines or the vectors EC, EA is 90 degree, obviously, right? Angle between EB and EC will be 45 degree. Similarly, angle between EA and EB will also be 45 degree. Why? Because EB is the extension of the diagonal of the square, right? Diagonal of the square is extended. So diagonal will obviously make 45 degree, 45 degree with the sides. The shape is a square. So this angle is also 45, this angle is also 45. Vertically opposite also you can consider. That will also give you the same angle between them. Now, what we need is resultant electric field at D. How many electric fields are acting at D? 3. EA, EB, EC. Now, question number 31. The net electric field at D is given by vector E is equal to vector EA plus vector EB plus vector EC. Right? So, from the simplification of previous problems, you might be thinking that, okay, now which two vectors to be chosen first? Okay, you might think like, okay, since EA and EC are perpendicular to each other, let us take that first. If you take EA and EC first, okay, fine, they are perpendicular to each other, it is easy to find the resultant of EA and EC. That's good. The magnitude of resultant of EA and EC can be found easily. It's simply root of EA squared plus EC squared, magnitude part of resultant of EA and EC. If I want to call it as EAC, EAC is equal to root of EA squared plus EC squared. But you also need to find the direction of these two, resultant of these two, EAC, right? Because once you get the value of EAC, in some direction, obviously it won't be in the same direction as of EB, right? Because EA is not equal to EC. If EA was equal to EC, then the resultant would be along EB itself, resultant of EA and EC. Following, if EA was equal to EC, then EAC would be in the same direction as of EB. But now that's not the case. You can observe here, the distance from A to D and C to D are same, but the charges kept at A and C are different. So obviously EC will be more than EA. We do not have EC equal to EA, so the resultant ECA won't be in the direction of EB. It's somewhat like towards EC. So we will not get the resultant in the same direction of EB, which will make the calculation complex. Because this is how we can expect the resultant of EA and EC, EAC. This is how EAC is expected, and you need to get the angle alpha, then you should subtract that alpha with this 45. So many things to do which will make the calculation clumsy. So what else we can do? So here, in order to avoid all this complex process, what we are going to do is, we are simply going to split this AB, okay? We will split this AB into two components. One component along EC, the other component along EA. Anyhow, the angle is 45 degree on both sides. So whatever the component of EB we will have along EC will be equal to the same along EA. Because it's 45 degree on both the sides, cos 45 is also same, sin 45 is also the same, both of them are same, 1 by root 2. So, upon splitting EB, okay, I can write EB as, okay, let me leave this part and split EB first. So, upon splitting EB, I can split EB into two components. One along EC, which will be EB cos 45, right? This EB split into two components, EB cos theta, EB sin theta, following. So this is our EB cos theta, and this is our EB sin theta. So, I can get the values of EA upon splitting. Okay, I don't need to represent it once again now. It's understood from the diagram itself, and that's fine. You can write that much, that would be enough. And now, let us find EB and EC first. So, what is EB equal to? First, write the formula once. E is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R squared. So, EB is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is 9 into 10 to the power of 9 Q for charge at B, okay? Charge at B is 2 nanocoulomb, 2 into 10 to the power of minus 9 divided by R squared. R squared is, for EB, R squared is BD, right? So what is BD? This is root 2, this is root 2, apply Pythagoras theorem, root of root 2 squared plus root 2 squared, which is 2 plus 2, 4, root 2, root of 4 is 2. Simplify this, you will get it. So it is 2 squared. Now, 9 into 10 to the power of 9, this, now they cancel each other. You should do one more step. I'll rub this 2 squared and write 4 directly. So 2 ones are, 2 twos are. What is left? This cancelled, these two cancelled. So 9 by 2 is left. What is 9 by 2? 4.5 Newton per coulomb. And now, work for EC. Same way, 9 into 10 to the power of 9 into charge at C is 3 nanocoulomb, 3 into 10 to the power of minus 9 divided by R squared, which is root 2 whole squared, 2. Simplify this. So this will be, this two will get cancelled, 9 3 is 27, 27 by 2 is 13.5 Newton per coulomb, right? Now, EA similarly, EA is equal to 9 into 10 to the power of 9, charge is 1 nanocoulomb divided by AB, which is root 2 squared, simply 2. Now, 9 by 2, which is actually equal to EB, 4.5 Newton per coulomb. So this is what is EA. So we now have the values of EA, EB and EC with us, right? So let me split EB into its components, EB cos theta and EB sin theta. EB cos theta is equal to, which is along this direction, is equal to, what is theta? EB is split into this 45 degree. So EB is 4.5 into cos 45. 4.5 into cos 45 is 1 by root 2. So it is 4.5 by root 2. Similarly, the vertical component EB sine theta, which is again, you will get the same value, okay? Simplify this, 4.5 by root 2. Now, why am I doing all these things? Because now, EC and EB cos theta are along same direction. Similarly, EA and EB sin theta are along same direction. So, these two electric fields, EA and EB sin theta, can simply be added, right? Because they are in the same direction. Similarly, EC and EB cos theta can be added to get the resultant along this and this direction. So now EB is simplified. Okay. So let me call the resultant of EB cos theta and EC as EBC. Okay. Now I am working for EBC here and EAB here. Okay. Right. So EBC is equal to EC plus EB cos theta, right? Because they are in the same direction. Now, what is EC? EC is 13.5. 13.5 plus EB cos theta is 4.5 by root 2. Simplify this, okay? So this is EBC. Similarly, let me work for EBA now, here. So EBA is equal to, since EB sin theta and EA are in same direction, EBA will be EA plus EB sin theta, which will be, what is EA? EA is 4.5. So it is 4.5 plus 4.5 by root 2. So now we have two electric fields left after simplifying three of this, right? We had three, EC, EB, EA. Now EB is split and put into EC and EA. So now we have only two left, EBC and EBA, okay? So this is how EBC will be and this is how EBA will be. Now look at this, EBC and EBA are actually perpendicular to each other, right? Since these two are perpendicular to each other, the resultant magnitude, which is the final, okay, now all the three are simplified. The final electric field or the net electric field at D is equal to root of EBC squared plus EBA squared. Simplify this, okay? Put these values, make use of the calculator, put these values into it and get the value of E, okay? And this E will be, okay, you need to do the calculation. I won't be doing it here. So this gives you the net electric field at point D due to the charges kept at A, B and C, okay? What is different in this problem compared to the previous one? In this problem, we are actually splitting an electric field into two components and into the direction of two known electric fields and solving the problem. In the previous problem, we have not taken this approach. We have directly taken, we'll be first concentrating on the vectors which are parallel to each other or opposite to each other. Okay? In the same direction or in the opposite direction, we'll solve them first. Then, using the resultant of those, we'll get few vectors, electric fields perpendicular to each other and we'll also solve them, right? That is what we did in the previous problem. But here, if we go for choosing two perpendicular vectors in the first case itself, we'll get stuck or the problem will become clumsy because the resultant of these two perpendicular is expected anywhere in between, right? Not exactly in the direction of EB. So, in order to avoid all these things, what we did is we split EB into EB cos theta, EB sin theta. EB cos theta is along EC, so we add them. EB sin theta is along EA, we add them. And this resultant EBC and EBA are perpendicular to each other, we'll get the resultant easily. Okay? So that is how we can solve this kind of problems. And here, if charges kept at A and C were equal, okay? On a special note, if the charges kept at A and C were equal, if they were equal, then we could have went for the first approach. Because if then EA would be equal to EC, then the resultant would be exactly in the direction of EB, if the charge at A and C were equal, right? If the charge at A and C were equal, EA would be equal to EC, then the resultant of EA and EC will be exactly along EB. So we will solve these two first and then go for EAC, which is in the same direction of EB, and hence the problem would be much simpler, right? But for this problem, we do not have EA equal to EC because A is not equal to C, right? So we have to go for this approach when A is not equal to C. Clear on this? Right. Now, moving ahead, the next problem, 32nd one, two identical pitch balls, each weighing 30 milligram, are hung from the same point of a rigid support by two threads, each of length 0.1 meter. when equal amount of identical charges are given to the pith balls, they get separated by 0.1 meter. Calculate the charge on each of them. So what we have here is two identical pith balls hung from a rigid support, right? So initially there are two threads of length 0.1 meter and hung from a rigid support. So this is how the pith balls look like in the absence of electric charge. Now when the electric charge is given to these pith balls, when they are electrified, the pith balls get separated. Obviously you are giving equal amount of charge to both the pith balls, they will repel each other. Once they repel each other, they tend to move away from each other. What is the this is also 0.1 meter. What is the distance of separation here? The distance of separation is 0.1 meter. Now, equal amount of charge is given to both of this. So let me say Q and Q is the charge given. They got separated by 0.1 meter. And what we need to find is the charge on each of them. So this Q has to be found, okay? So now what they've given is, before the pith balls getting charged, they are close to each other. Once they are once they got charged, they tend to ripple and move away from by the distance of 0.1 meter, like this. Now let me consider one of the pith ball, okay? So now this pith ball is in rest, it's in equilibrium. When a pith ball or any body in rest or in equilibrium, all the forces on it should be cancelling, right? Which are the forces acting on this pith ball? Now, you see, obviously weight of the ball will be pulling it down, right? Which is equal to mg. Weight will be pulling it down. And electrostatic force of repulsion between these two balls, let me call that as F, okay? This F or Fe, electrostatic force of repulsion between these two charges, will be pushing the charge in this direction, right? So now we have two forces acting, and the resultant of these two will be in this direction exactly, which is opposite to that of the tension in the string, right? So this is the resultant of Fe and W. Now we can work with the Pythagoras theorem here because we'll be needing it. Now can we find W? Yes, it's easy, we can find, right? Can we find electrostatic force? Obviously we can't find the force of repulsion numerically, but we can express this electrostatic force in terms of Q. That is possible, right? We can do that now. So now we have W numerically, Fe. Now, and the angle between these two, angle between these two is 90 degree, right? Because weight always acts towards the center of the earth, downwards. Electrostatic force acts always along the line joining two charges. So this is the line joining two charges, and this is how the electrostatic force acts. So weight and electrostatic force are perpendicular to each other. We have this much of data with us. And we can actually work for this angle, right? What is that angle? That angle is same as this. So this is resultant of these two. Let me call that as resultant force, right? F. So now this F will make certain angle alpha with one of the vector Fe. Obviously one of the this resultant will make angle alpha with any one of this forces. I have chosen this force, which will come in the denominator. Now So with this much of data available, let me proceed to find W first. W is equal to mg, mass is 30 milligram, which is 30 into 10 to the power of minus 3 kg into g, acceleration due to gravity. Let us consider that as 10, not a problem, we can consider it as 10. Sometimes they will mention particularly, take g as 9.8 meter per second square. Till then you don't need to worry, you can directly take it as 10. So together it is 30 into 10, okay, it is 10 to the power of minus 2 minus 1 0.3 newton, right? So this is 30 into 10 to the power of minus 3 minus 2, yeah, 0.3. or it will be easy for me to simplify. Let me keep it as 3 into 10 to the power of minus 1 newton. So this is the weight. Similarly, what is Fe, electrostatic force of repulsion? Write the formula once. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 by R squared. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is 9 into 10 to the power of 9. We don't know what is Q1 Q2, but they are identical, that much we know. So Q squared by R squared. What is R? Distance between the pit balls. They got separated by 0.1 meter, right? Which means this R is 0.1 meter, which is 10 to the power of minus 1 whole square. Now, so Fe now becomes equal to 9 Q squared into 10 to the power of 9. This minus 2 comes to the numerator, becomes 11, right? 9 Q square into 10 to the power of 11 newton. So this Q has to be found, which is not yet found. Now, from this, when theta is equal to 90 degree, right, the angle between these two forces, it's all about vector addition. You should remember all those things properly or refer to the first year notes, you will get it. When theta is equal to 90 degree, obviously theta is equal to 90 degree here. So once you write the formula of alpha, right, or tan alpha, tan alpha is equal to it is, the general formula is P sine theta by Q plus P cos theta, right? Now what is P? P is one vector, which is force here, which should be Fe, because Q should be, Q should be Fe, right? Because this is the one which decides with respect to which alpha is measured. So it is Fe plus P should be this W, right? W cos 90, in the numerator W sin 90. So this term vanish, cos 90 is 0, sin 90 is 1. So it is simply tan alpha is equal to W by Fe, right? What is W? Simplify that. 3 into 10 to the power of minus 1. What is Fe? Fe is here. 9 Q squared into 10 to the power of minus 11. Which is equal to 3 1s are 3 3s are. So 10 to the power of 11 upon coming to the numerator becomes plus 11. So 10 to the power of 10 divided by, see, 3 Q square is left in the denominator. Clear on this? It's just simplification. You can do it by yourself. Now, let us concentrate on this tan alpha geometrically. Okay? Look at this. If this is alpha, vertically opposite angle, this should also be alpha. Right? And this is our 0.1 meter length. And what is this side? The adjacent side of this right angle triangle. From here to here it is 1 meter, 0.1 meter. So from here to here it is going to be 0.05 meter, right? 0.05 meter. Got it? So 0.05 is in the adjacent side of the triangle and 0.1 meter is in the hypotenuse side of the triangle. What we need is tan alpha, right? Again, it's difficult to get tan alpha because what we have there is adjacent and hypotenuse. And what we need is this, the opposite side, okay? Which will be equal to root of 0.1 squared minus 0.05 squared, okay? Simplify this, you will get this side, value of this side, excuse. Once you have the opposite side, use Pythagoras theorem, not a complex one, okay? You will have the opposite side value and the adjacent side value so that you can get tan alpha, okay? Let me name this triangle so that it becomes easy for you. It is A, this point B A, this point B B, and this point B C, and this point B D. So tan alpha is actually equal to A D opposite by adjacent C D, right? Use Pythagoras theorem, get AD, simplify that here, CD is 0.1, simplify, you will get tan alpha, right? You have the value of tan alpha, here you have 10 to the power of 10 by 3 q squared. Once again, you simplify bar, simplify for q, you will get the value of charge. So on, so cool. Clear on this? You should do all the calculations, okay? It's all math part which is left. Do it. So the next question, 33rd one. A pendulum bob of mass 0.2 gram and carrying a charge of 20 nanocoulomb is at rest in a horizontal uniform electric field of 3 into 10 to the power of 4 Newton per coulomb. Find the angle it makes with the vertical and tension in the string. Okay? So, yeah, here you have a single charge kept in uniform external field. Okay? Yeah, it's not that easy to visualize how the charge is going to move or tend or it diagrammatically. So this is the bob and this is the uniform external field present. So when the external field is applied, this bob will experience a force like this and hence it tends to move in this direction. So this is the equilibrium position of the given bob. This ball has two forces acting similar to that of the previous case. One is weight, W is equal to mg, and the other is electrostatic repulsion, which is like this. Let me call that as Fe. Now, what is asked to find? Find the angle it makes with the vertical. So this angle has to be found now, right? Let me call that as angle as alpha. So this thread will have the same direction as of the resultant force acting on the ball, right? So this will be the resultant force acting, and hence if this is alpha, this will also be alpha. Following? So now we have all the arrangements. So similar to that of the previous one, but here we can find W, we can find Fe. What is asked to find? The tension in the string and the alpha. See, since it's in equilibrium, tension will be in the opposite direction, the net force will be in this direction. So they cancel with each other. Once they cancel with each other, it becomes equilibrium. When they cancel with each other, when they are equal to each other, right? So this force and the tension are equal, which means we need to find the resultant force. That itself is the tension acting along the string, right? And we need to get the value of alpha, right? So this F is the resultant of Fe and W. First, let me work for Fe. Fe is equal to Eq this time, right? When the charge is kept in uniform external field, the force experienced by it is Eq, which is equal to E is given, which is 3 into 10 to the power of 4, and Q, charge is 20 nanocoulomb, right? To 20 into 10 to the power of minus 9. So Fe in this direction is 3 to 6 into 10 to the power of 4 plus 1, 5, minus 9, 4. 6 into 10 to the power of minus 4 newton is Fe. And what about the weight, W, mg? It's 0.2 gram, which is 0.2 into 10 to the power of minus 3 into acceleration due to gravity B, 10. That makes W is equal to 2 into 10 to the power of minus 1, minus 3, which is minus 4. So minus 4 plus 1, which is 10 to the power of minus 3. I can express this as 20 into 10 to the power of minus 4 newton. Okay, you simplify, you'll get it. That's not difficult. So you have W and Fe, the resultant F, or I can say tension is equal to resultant F is equal to under root of this square plus this square, because the angle between them is 90 degree. So this is 6 into 10 to the power of minus 4 squared plus 20 into 10 to the power of minus 4 squared. Okay, so 10 to the power of minus 4 can be taken outside. What is left inside is 6 square 36, 20 squared 400. Simplify it using the calculator, you will get the force acting in newton. This itself is the tension. Okay, so the tension acting along the string is this much newton. Clear? Right. And now it's time to get the value of alpha. So it's simple. Tan alpha is equal to opposite by adjacent, right? We don't need to go for opposite by adjacent. We don't have much information about the geometry. We do have the information about the forces. So since theta is equal to 90 degree, I can write directly. So this, since this I have considered as alpha, say I can shift this Fe here so that tan alpha opposite by adjacent. So once you can write the general formula, that's also fine, okay? P sine theta by Q plus P cos theta. Which is Q here? W is Q. So P is Fe and theta is 90 degrees. So this, that makes tan alpha is equal to Fe by W. Simplify this. Fe is 6, W is 20. Get the ratio, you'll get the value of tan alpha. Once you have the value of tan alpha, then make use of the Clark's table and get the value of alpha. That's it. Okay, you should do all the rest of the things. You should work for tension and the value of alpha by yourself. Thank you very much. And this finishes the problems on electric charges and fields.